Hey guys, thanks for tuning in to another video on ForgottenWeapons.com. I'm Ian McCollum, and today we're going to talk about rate of fire in machine guns. I think this is a really interesting subject. It's one I get a lot of questions about. And so the questions are really, what determines the rate of fire of a gun? Can you, as a designer, make choices to impact that? Obviously you can, but what are those choices? What are the factors that can cause a gun to fire fast or fire slow? And if you have a design and you want to either increase or decrease its rate of fire, how would one go about doing that? So to start with, I'm going to leave out all discussion about what rate of fire is best. That depends on what you're doing with the gun, and it's a complex subject that's worth its whole own standalone video. If you're really curious about it, let me know in the comments, and maybe we'll do a video on that one, that question as well. But fundamentally, what makes this interesting to me is there is such a wide range of rates of fire in guns. We have everything from, you know, Shoshas, they're firing 400 rounds a minute, despite having full power rifle cartridges, all the way down to lots of like little stereotypical tiny machine pistols that are shooting at insane rates of fire north of 1500 rounds per minute. Like, what's the deal? Well, first off, it's actually really simple. The rate of fire of the gun is specifically determined by the time that it takes the bolt to cycle from firing one round to being ready to fire the second round, or firing one round to firing the second round. So how long does it take for the bolt to cycle open, extract, eject the empty case, stop, return forward, pick up a new round, chamber it, and then fire that round? That, in a nutshell, is the very definition of rate of fire. How long does each cycle take? So what determines that? Well, two things determine that. The first is, how far does the bolt have to travel in order to make this cycle? The shorter of a distance it has to travel, typically the faster it's going to do it. And the second factor is, what is the average bolt velocity? Of course, the bolt's not moving at a constant velocity during this process. It's going to accelerate and decelerate going both directions. But if we just simplify this to average bolt velocity, well, the higher the average velocity, the higher the rate of fire, the faster this cycle is going to go. Okay, so distance of travel is pretty much a fixed thing. It is what it is. We're going to leave that alone. It's pretty simple. Bolt velocity has a number of factors that come into play, though. So for a simple blowback firearm, your bolt velocity is going to be the result of the weight of the bolt, or rather the mass of the bolt, and the amount of energy, the force that's being put into it when the gun fires. So with simple blowback, when you fire, the bullet's going that way, the case is pushing this way, and the case is pushing on the bolt itself. Since we stipulated simple blowback, there's nothing else holding the bolt closed. And so those two are simply going to open with equal energy going in both directions. Now, because the bolt is much heavier than the bolt's going to start accelerating much more slowly. And this is where you can see the one really simple variable for determining rate of fire in a simple blowback submachine gun, and that is the weight of the bolt. If you want it to fire faster, you reduce the mass of the bolt, which then increases the bolt's average velocity, which reduces the cycle time, which increases the rate of fire. Pretty simple, right? You want the gun to go slower, add mass to the bolt. If we have a more complicated system, like a locked breech system, then there are other factors that come into play. So if you have a gas piston system, typically the piston, you're going to divert gas out of the barrel into the gas piston. That's going to serve to unlock the action. So before you, as long as the action's locked, that pressure on the bolt face doesn't actually open it because it's locked. That's the whole point. And so depending on the gun, the bullet may be out of the barrel by the time the action unlocks, or it may not be. Regardless, either way, you'll have a varying amount of pressure still pushing backwards on that bolt face once it's unlocked and able to move backwards. You might have a lot, you might have very little. If the bullet's left the barrel and there's enough time for gas pressure to have blown out the muzzle, you may have very little residual gas pressure pushing on the bolt face, and you may just have the movement of the operating rod going backwards. So that operating rod, once it gets moving, it has some inertia, it's going to want to continue moving, and it's going to, once it unlocks the bolt, I keep doing this because often this is a rotating bolt, it's going to unlock the bolt and then it's going to push it backwards. Once again, mass comes into play here, but also basically the mass and velocity of the operating rod or the gas piston or the bolt carrier comes into play here. So again, you can alter the rate of fire of the gun by changing the mass of all of those other parts, or by increasing or reducing the size of the gas port, essentially changing the amount of gas pressure that's getting tapped off the barrel and put into the gas piston. One place where you can see this exemplified, by the way, unintentionally, is with the very early Vietnam use of the M16. The formulation of the gunpowder was changed, which resulted in a higher port pressure, higher gas pressure at the gas port, which resulted in more pressure coming back and pushing on the bolt carrier, which increased the bolt carrier velocity, which increased the rate of fire, which then had a number of deleterious effects on the guns themselves. Things like outrunning the magazines, and just putting a lot more wear and tear on the gun than was intended. So one example of how this can impact guns unintentionally. Now let's go back to these two guns that I pulled out earlier and just do a couple quick case studies of how these factors that I've just described affect these guns. First off, M11A1. It's a 380 caliber tiny little machine pistol. This has a very short bolt throw. It has a very light bolt. There's not a lot of metal in here. It doesn't have a particularly powerful cartridge, but that light bolt combined with the short receiver length means that this bolt is going to go flying back, it's going to accelerate quickly, it's going to hit the back of the receiver, and instead of having time to gently slow down to decelerate to zero and then get pushed backwards by the spring, or pushed forwards by the spring, the recoil spring, instead, this thing slams right back into the back of the receiver, bounces off the back of the receiver, and goes forward very quickly. This gives it a very high rate of fire. By contrast, the Shosha here, first off, has a much longer receiver. It also has a very heavy mass of reciprocating parts, because this is a long recoil action, so the bolt and the barrel itself, inside this shroud, are both moving back together. So you have the weight of the barrel and its cooling shroud and the bolt and some of the extra stuff hanging off the inside. All of that has to cycle all the way backwards down here until it reaches end of travel. Now this also does, it doesn't slow down gently to a complete zero. This does impact the back of the receiver. But then it also has to release the barrel. So long recoil guns have an extra element here in that the bolt is held backward until the barrel cycles forward, locks into place. That then releases the bolt, which of course takes more time. So part of our bolt cycle here involves the bolt being locked in the back of the receiver and just sitting here waiting for the barrel to cycle forward. Once that does happen, then the bolt can move forward, chamber a new cartridge, and fire again. This, of course, is going to have a very slow rate of fire. And then, of course, we have all sorts of other guns filling the spectrum in between. And, you know, 600 to 1,000 rounds per minute is really the sort of typical general rate of fire for most machine guns. Okay, so now we have a machine gun. Let's say we want to change the rate of fire in it. How would we go about doing that from a design perspective? Well, it's simple. Any of these factors that I've already brought up, change them, and they'll either increase or decrease the rate of fire. So fundamentally, length of travel of the bolt. If you make the receiver longer or shorter, that's going to very directly impact the rate of fire. Now, you might be thinking, yeah, that's not really an option. You can't just like cut part of the receiver off. But actually, in a way, you sort of can, and there are some examples of this. So, for example, the Czech ZB-37 heavy machine gun was set up with a dual rate of fire system, fast for anti-aircraft use, slow for infantry use, or however else you wanted to use it. But the way that they made the gun faster was by actually rotating a block down into the receiver that would shorten the bolt throw by over an inch. It had a little hydraulic buffer in it to absorb some of the impact of the bolt, but that right there, it just simply by shortening the receiver travel, the gun shot faster. Another example would be the Soviet DS-39 Degtyarev machine guns. They had a lot of problems that I get into in my DS-39 video, but it was also another gun that had was set up with a dual rate of fire system. And in this case, it was a two-element system. So there was a buffer that you could engage or disengage at the back of the receiver. And that, again, would either gently decelerate the bolt at the end of travel or not. If the bolt comes back, hits the receiver, and bounces forward, it's going to be shooting faster than if it hits a buffer, which then has to decelerate before the bolt can return. That slows down your rate of fire. The DS-39 also had two gas ports in it. This was a gas-operated gun, and by moving from the small gas port to the large gas port, you would increase the rearward velocity of the operating rod, which then in turn increased the velocity of the bolt when it opened and cycled. So by engaging, by operating the, changing the buffer and the gas port in tandem, you could go from, that was like 600 rounds per minute to 900 rounds per minute, a pretty substantial overall change. You're talking about a 50% increase in rate of fire. Now, if you want to reduce the rate of fire, say you're happy with the top end rate of fire, but you want to have a slower option, or you just want to reduce the rate of fire in general, there are some things you can do with mechanical delays in the trigger mechanism. So one good example of this would be the FN Model D, where there is actually a spring-loaded, basically it's just a mechanical delay in the trigger mechanism. If you set the gun to the slow rate of fire, then when the bolt comes back, it hits a ramp and it has to depress this ramp down in order to cycle the bolt fully back. And depressing that ramp requires winding a gear against a spring. It's just a complication in there intended to slow down the action of the gun. And that's exactly what it does. There's a similar mechanism to this in like the Astra Model F machine pistol, where there's sort of essentially a mechanical zigzag weight in the grip that has to bounce back and forth before the bolt can close and fire again. Those are mechanisms that can reduce the rate of fire just through almost like an element in a watch, through a mechanical complication built into the grip assembly. And that's a mechanism that you can usually pretty easily isolate with a selector switch. So it's a way to get a high versus low rate of fire in the gun if you want to retain the option of the full high-end potential rate of fire of that gun. Anyway, hopefully you guys found this discussion interesting. If you would like me to go into some detail about what rate of fire is best for what purposes, let me know down in the comments, and perhaps we'll do that as a video as well. Thanks for watching.